want to tweet about an event and you hear what our speakers think, it's hashtag SWCYWN17. So please feel free. Before you come in today, you're all asked to sign a consent form because we're going to video this event with lots of pictures taken. If you're uncomfortable with us taking your picture or using your pictures, can you let Debbie and Shari know? Can Debbie and Shari make themselves seen? I don't know where Shari is, but Debbie. Speak to Debbie. Any objections to us using your pictures, please let her know. We'll make sure we don't do it. Today's event is about empowerment for young women and what they need to succeed in employment, education and society. We feel that it's important that young women are given a safe, friendly and supportive place to share their thoughts and experiences, because after all you are a future. We all need that bit extra help to succeed, but if you need help, where do you go to find it? Who do you turn to? Who can you trust? Who will give you that extra support you need and confidence when you're feeling down? And especially when you're at school, college, university, who do you go for help? When you're looking for a job, who do you get help from? In today's culture, the media shows young women, and particularly young women, in a very negative way. We often portrayed in provocative sexy images. The language that's used to talk about young women is often quite offensive. And we need to have that discussion. Is that how young women want to be thought of, what they want to be talked about? We hope today that some of these issues will come out. We will have four great speakers who will share their stories, and we'll have workshops this afternoon to allow you to have those discussions. We hope today is going to be a fun event for you, and we'll have a question and answer session after you hear the speakers. As I've said, we'll put some workshops after lunch, and we hope that you will be able to discuss some of the issues that are important to you. You all have wristbands which will tell you what workshop you're placed in. After the speakers, we'll come and tell you a bit more about that. And finally, before I move on to the speakers, you were given a quiz this morning when you came in. It could be asked you complete that and then give it to the staff before you leave. It's just to kind of get our idea of what you think of some of the issues that are important to you on today. Now enough from me. I'm going to pass over to our speakers. I'm going to introduce our first speaker, which is Rosa Sala. Rosa came to this country in 2002 as a refugee from Iraq, but she is most famously known as a Glasgow girl, where herself and a group of her friends took up the UK Immigration Service to protest against the concept of Dawn Raids. Rosa.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for having me. I thought I'm actually going to speak for my people. So basically, I wanted to kind of talk to you in a more informal, instead of just, you know, reading my speech and kind of, it's not very interactive. So I'd like to talk about a few things of like my campaign and, you know, the Glasgow Girls kind of campaign, what you can learn from it, and what you can take away. And because our campaign actually started about kind of roughly like your age, and what you can do with this today, what you can take with and what you can challenge, and what's challenging for you today, what is a barrier for you today, could be anything. So basically the Glasgow Girls campaign is about seven young women from a school, in high school, challenging deportation and detention of young children. So you might think, oh, this is a huge campaign, and I don't think I can do such a big campaign if I wanted to do. But to be honest with you, we only wanted to save our friend from a school, which was Drumchapel High School. So we started with a petition to save our friend from the school. I want to first, before I speak about the campaign and how it started, if we could show the video. It's very short, it's about 4 minutes, and you can kind of get a rough idea what was the Glasgow Girls about, and then I can talk about more after the video. Then if you can just play that, that'd be excellent.
In 2005, the lives of these 15-year-old schoolgirls from Drumchapel High School in Glasgow changed forever. One of them, Agnesa Mursalai, had been settled in Scotland for 5 years. She and her family had fled their homeland of Kosovo as their lives were in danger and they were seeking asylum in the UK. But at dawn on the 6th of March, without warning, immigration officers removed them from their home against their will, drove them hundreds of miles to a detention centre where they were held to await deportation. Devastated by Agnesa's sudden disappearance, her school friends began a campaign to stop her deportation.
We started a petition for Agnesa's family, and hundreds of people from our school and local community signed it.
I just find it disgusting. Agnesa has been working hard here. She's applied for college, she's got high hopes, and then all of a sudden, she's just put away from it all. It's like our dreams have just been ruined.
The girls contacted newspapers, TV and radio stations and successfully stopped the family's deportation so that they could return home to Glasgow.
The Children's Commissioner has condemned the way a family of failed Kosovan asylum seekers were evicted from their home in an early morning raid.
But the dawn raids didn't stop and the children continued to disappear without warning.
The Vukac family doesn't live here anymore. This is the Glasgow home they were taken from in a dawn raid last Tuesday when their asylum application was turned down. They've left much of their lives behind.
Spurred on by a fierce sense of injustice, the girls kept campaigning for the rights of asylum-seeking children and families. They took their fight to the First Minister of Scotland.
The teenagers held talks with the First Minister, who's now promising to lobby the Home Office for a more sensitive approach to removals involving children, which avoids existing tactics.
The girls' campaign received widespread acclaim and they won awards for their achievements.
Please welcome from Drumchapel High School, the Glasgow Girls.
Their story has been the inspiration for two BBC documentaries in 2005 and 2006.
The things that really stand out for me were the bits of footage that they recorded themselves, which gave you a really profound insight into the mindset and the perceptions of a child going through a situation and a worry, a constant worry, that a lot of us just sail through life and never have to think about.
In 2013, a National Theatre of Scotland musical took to the stage.
There were so many reasons that I wanted to tackle this story. On so many levels, it excited me and inspired me, and I thought it was an important story to tell.
Come and try to snatch my cross these days when I'm not my house there.
And in 2014, a BBC television drama hit our screens.
I first heard the Glasgow Girls story when I saw a documentary. And I remember thinking at the time what an amazing story it was, what an amazing film it was. And thinking, what an incredible drama that would be.
Ten years on, we brought six of the girls back to the school where it all began, to reflect on all the different ways their stories have been told.
So kind of like gives you kind of a rough idea what our campaign was about. Sorry about the other people in this side couldn't see the video very properly. So the Glasgow Girls, it was about our friend from a school. We campaigned for her. Basically to release her from prison and she get her freedom. So we started from our school basically with really simple petition from our classroom and students. And they signed it and we took this petition to the whole of the school and then we take it to the community, then we took it and we sent it to journalists, then we took it to the media. So basically it started very small and became such a big public campaign. So I really like want to talk about of where actually kind of understand where who are asylum seekers as well. Like asylum seekers seek asylum because they are in danger of prosecution from their own country, so they're running away from fear and they are seeking asylum. So that's why a lot of people are claiming asylum and coming to Europe. So kind of I wanted to say from the Glasgow Girls, we didn't actually win everything that we wanted to end detention and deportation, but we did raise the profile of child detention, and we also ended child detention in the UK. So that's huge accomplishment. And also the United Nations didn't have the welfare of an asylum child as in the charter. The charter didn't include the welfare of the child of being an asylum seeker. And we actually added that into the pledge of child refugees put on the agenda. So they're included in that legislation as well. But also we highlighted the pledge of asylum seekers in total, and we also kind of raised the agenda of how we can have a different form of a system of we don't have detention centers and we don't have detaining basically people who are innocent and more look forward to other countries where they have a different model, like a Scandinavian model, where people are not really detained for seeking asylum. And that's a really different system we could look forward to and change. So we have kind of changed the perspective of our government seeking new reform. But until today, you can see there's a lot of problems and they haven't reformed any of that. Still people being detained, but our campaign changed end of child detention. So children are no longer in detention. They cannot, it's illegal. And for our awards, we won recently a BAFTA of Scotland Awards, and that was the best television drama, and it came to all of our screens, and the BBC film was really, I think young people were inspired by it, and many people, you know, I go along and I'm like, you're one of the Glasgow Girls, I actually, you inspired me, I campaigned about this. Your campaign is basically different to what I went through or what I experienced and what is injustice for you. Like at the moment I'm involved in another campaign of Better Than Zero campaign. It's basically 0-hour contracts, and young people really like feel strongly against the 0-hour contract. So it could be anything that you're passionate about, and I want you to take away from kind of my campaign and experience that you can actually make a difference, even though you think, oh, this is a small idea. I know, I'm just thinking of this, but I don't really want to do it. It's going to take a lot of time, or there's not a lot of people thinking the same. But if you speak about it, there might be a lot of other people thinking the same thing as you are, and collectively you can make a difference on whatever that may be for you. So kind of just, I haven't really spoken about kind of my campaign, because after the Glasgow Girls, I did move on to other things. I went to university, I graduated with a law degree in politics, and from then on, I campaigned for asylum seeker scholarships because it was a restraint for a lot of people who couldn't go to universities and they couldn't access higher education. So I changed that, and at the moment there are scholarships at Strathclyde University, Glasgow University, University of West of Scotland. So it's been implemented throughout all the institutions, from just my campaign in Strathclyde University for this scholarship. It has changed people's lives, because you know, when you're an asylum seeker and you cannot access the student loans that we have a privilege of in this country, they don't have access to that. And they're in a limbo where their life is like they're not a human being. They're just waiting for a decision by the Home Office for their life to begin. And this scholarship has given them hope that they can continue life, and they have a hope of achieving something, you know, that from their merits, from who they are as a person. So I think that any of you in this room, you're capable of so much you can do. And I hope from today you can take away that whatever it is you want to campaign, you can do it, make a difference. But I believe that collectively you can achieve so much more. And I hope that you're strong women today and you've come along to such a great event. You learned this and you take away. And I hope that your future is bright. And all the best and luck for you, for your future.
Frustrated with the lack of active sports available dream to be a doctor. Elizabeth was the first person I have met in a wheelchair who was independent, ambitious and determined to achieve in life. She was feisty and fierce and wouldn't take no for an answer. I was amazed to see someone who was disabled like me taking on life in such a proactive way. Elizabeth showed me what empowerment meant. She inspired me to be more independent because she was so determined not to let her disability stop her from doing anything. Before the Dragons, I had never been involved with any team sports, so the whole team mentality was a completely new concept for me. I also never played any kind of sport involving balls. In fact, I used to have a fear of balls, considering it now, spend every day training and playing with either a basketball or a rugby ball, this now makes me laugh. Initially, I played wheelchair rugby, which at that point in my life was the only sport that the Dragons offered. I couldn't pass or catch the ball to save myself, and in comparison to everyone else, I was slow and didn't have great cheer skills. Although this sounds like a negative, for me it was a positive because for the first time in a long time, I wanted to get better at something and I wanted to achieve. The Dragons welcomed me into their family, and for the first time in my life, I felt accepted for who I was. I felt I belonged and started to get active and fit. I had friends, I felt part of a team, and because of this, my mental health started to improve massively. This leads me on to the next stage of my journey to empowerment. Out of the blue, I received a phone call from Tina Gordon, who is a wheelchair basketball development officer. She had been in contact with Elizabeth to see if there was anyone under the age of 19 who played wheelchair rugby league at the Dragons who might be good enough to compete at wheelchair basketball for Scotland in the school games. It was 3 weeks before the competition. I had never played a game of wheelchair basketball in my life. Tina seemed so calm and positive on the phone while me and my mum were freaking out. Something inside me told me that I should take this opportunity even though it seemed scary. So I did. 3 weeks later, I was on a bus to Sheffield about to play my first game of wheelchair basketball and I was competing for my country. I never felt so nervous in my life. The whole thing seemed so daunting. Mum was also very nervous too. She thought I may break down with the pressure. The school games was unlike anything I'd ever witnessed before. It totally changed my perspective on disability. I saw young people who were driving cars, going to uni, who had trendy wheelchairs. And, you know, I saw them and I thought I wanted to be like that. After the school games changed me. It made me want to become independent. And as everyone else did, things like push their own sports chairs, carry their own bags, push themselves up hills without any help. I wouldn't have attempted to do any of these things myself when I was at my low point and would have relied on someone else to help me. To you, these might seem like small things, but to me, these types of things were about empowerment, doing things for myself and being independent. It took me ages to master these skills, and even now I still struggle with some of them, but I will never forget the sense of achievement I felt after I managed to push my sports chair whilst in my day chair. This is advanced wheelchair driving. On the court, it was a steep learning curve as I didn't know the rules or anything about basketball. Tina had faith and belief in me when I didn't have it in myself, and she made me see I could play a crucial role in a team despite my level of disability. After the school games, I started to play basketball and I fell in love with the sport. After so many years of feeling like an outsider, I finally felt a sense of belonging. Over the next few years, I gained the role of captain, which increased my confidence as I was given a responsibility and a leadership role. Supporting my teammates on and off the court made me feel appreciated and valued. But in this role, I also found my voice. Tina listened to me, and knowing that my opinion and my knowledge was valued by someone who I respected and admired, made me feel empowered. So, where now? I wanted to give back to the sport and to be able to help improve people's lives through sport, so I started coaching. I love being able to help people to develop on I'm finding that I'm building strength, stamina, and my mental resilience. I train every day, and I see myself physically improve, and I am constantly setting new goals and new targets, both on and off the court. Next week, I start the next chapter of my life as a student at Aberdeen University in Dundee. I was so proud to be accepted to study sport and exercise. Considering where I have come from, this is a huge achievement. For someone with a disability, empowerment may always be a journey, as sometimes taking full control is a challenge. However, I'm up for this challenge no matter how long it takes.
Our next speaker is Paula Dunn. She is a support worker from the Rosie Project at Glasgow at Clyde Rape Crisis. The Rosie Project offers sexual violence and gender socialisation awareness for young people. Paula's spoken for us before and we're very happy to have her back.
Paula. Hiya. Apologies. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Hi everyone. Thank you for having me today. So as you heard, I work for Glasgow Rape Crisis, one of the prevention workers there, and the Rosie Project. So I'm going to tell you a bit about the Rosie Project and what we do. Yeah, so the project started almost 10 years ago now, and I was the first worker on the Rosie Project, and the project came about because of the high numbers of young women that were accessing our service for sexual violence. We were seeing an increase in it. We were doing a lot of community work around helping young women who were experiencing sexual violence, and we realised that we were there to offer that support, which was fantastic, but what we wanted to do was some prevention work, and we set about setting up the Rosie Project. We know that research tells us that education and early intervention is key to recovery for young people who are survivors of sexual violence. So that's what we wanted to do. Instead of, you know, just saying like, let's provide that support, which we do, we wanted to also find out what's going on, why is it such a problem, why is there a rise in sexual violence in the 13 to 25 year old age group? Where are young people getting their messages from? So that's where we came from. So our prevention work is into two strands. I'm the community prevention worker, so I go out to youth groups, Prince's Trust, GAMH, places like that, all your local community groups, and I work with young people, boys and girls, from the age of 11 to 25, because what we think is really important is that boys and girls are getting the same message about equality, the same message about what's appropriate in relationships, and the same message about sexual violence, and we really want to engage boys and girls in this conversation. It's the only way we're going to change it. So I do that in the community. My colleague Kim does it in the high schools in Glasgow, and we have two fabulous support workers who carry out all the support work for our 13 to 25 year old age group. Now, when we were doing this work, we also didn't have the funding for it. We're a charity. Glasgow and Clyde Rape Crisis is a charity. So we set about getting our manager set about getting the funding for that. So my funding is from the lottery. The lottery are really the big lottery fund. They're really keen to support this kind of work and recognise that young people in Scotland and in Glasgow, you know, are, you know, there's a lot of young survivors of sexual violence, and the government is obviously taking, you know, with their Equally Safe initiative, are taking a stand on this issue. So they're really keen to fund us, and the Scottish Government and the Lottery fund our posts. And BBC Children in Need fund that support work that we do. So we're very lucky to have those partnerships, and we're very lucky to have that funding. But as some of you might know, as a charity, we're constantly chasing that funding, constantly saying that there's a need, and we have, you know, created that need that we need to then support. So we, in order to do that, we felt we had to create partnerships because when we first started the project, we were kind of dipping in and out of community groups and dipping in and out of high schools and not really sure what kind of difference we were making. So we thought it was important to develop those partnerships and then evaluate that those partnerships to see where those changes are being made. So not all of you will be able to see, but we have created amazing partnerships with a lot of the high schools in Glasgow. They're really keen to get this message into their schools, and I've developed a lot of partnerships with the youth groups and all the colleges, so Glasgow Plaid colleges and Glasgow Kelvin colleges as well. And Rosie Project and Rape Crisis have been instrumental in implementing the EcoSafe project into Strathclyde University, and we're part of the training process for that to make sure that all students, especially female students at Strathclyde University, are studying in a safe environment free from any kind of sexual violence or domestic abuse. So we do a variety of workshops in order to do this, which obviously it's a difficult subject to talk to anyone about, but when you're talking to young people about sexual violence, obviously sexual violence is still a taboo subject. You know, years ago, domestic abuse, we were at that point, you know, people are a wee bit more open to talking about domestic abuse and a wee bit more open of, you know, to having that dialogue. Sexual violence, not so much. People still don't want to acknowledge that it's a problem, maybe not want to acknowledge it's a problem in their area, in their school, in their community. So we want to kind of get that conversation started and get young people talking about it, and also get young people talking about sex and relationships and what are healthy relationships and what's appropriate within a relationship and recognising abuse within relationships. You know, Scotland or the UK, you know, we're still at that point where we don't want to talk to young people about sex. You know, it's something they should talk about, it's something that, you know, that's bad, that's a secret, and that's how abuse thrives. It thrives in secrecy, and the only way that we can challenge it is if we are comfortable talking about it. You know, I went to workshops and especially when there's boys there and you use the word penis and then everybody starts giggling, you know, and we're talking about 15 and 16 year old boys, you know, and it's like because we're conditioned and we're socialised not to talk about things like that, but that's when things are happening that people aren't happy with, they're too scared to speak out about it. So that's what our workshops hopefully are able to do. And we do that through our kind of gender socialisation, we do it through advertising, through the music industry. This is just an example of our advertising workshop where we try to see how sexual violence is minimised, how it's accepted, how it's not acknowledged as something that's really damaging. And you can see, some of you might be able to see from the images, you know, the Dolce & Gabbana are actually really famous, are infamous I should say, for using sexually violent and abusive images to sell their products, and all the other images, Sicily. So we think, what do young people do? Right, they like to buy clothes, they like to look at advertising, they like to the music industry, you know, there's social media. So we use all these things to try and get young people to talk about what's happening, where are you getting your messages from. It's important to understand that nobody has an original thought. Every thought that you have comes from what you're exposed to. And if you're exposed to the normalisation of sexual violence and the normalisation of domestic abuse, you might think that that's okay. So our workshops to try and get young people to think about that. And what we really want to do, a wee bit like Rosa was talking about, we really want to get young people campaigning. So, you know, we go in and we do all these workshops and everybody gets horrified about what's going on. And then what can we do about it? So there are many, many campaigns that are already out there. At the top there, we've got the Rape Crisis Scotland campaigns. This is not an invitation to rape me. And their new I Just Froze campaign. So really, really simple things that you can do. At the bottom right, we've got the police campaign. And that was directly, that was for men. You know, that was to get men engaged in this conversation. When we're doing our workshops, boys and men get very defensive, because we obviously talk about sexual violence as a gender crime, because that's what it is. And, you know, they get quite defensive, and we're always like, well, that's not what we're saying. We're not saying that every man and boy is a potential sex offender. What we're saying is that the only way we can challenge this is if we're all saying the same thing. So the Police Scotland did a great campaign directed at men, because many of the campaigns are directed at women when we're not the problem. You know, our gender is not the problem. So that was a really good campaign, and then obviously your zero tolerance campaigns as well. things that people can do when you get outraged about what's happening. There's loads of simple things that you can do. And now that what did happen when I was your age, social media, you know, you've just got this amazing platform that you can make your voice heard really easily. So last year, you know, when we're doing this work, as I say, it's grown and growing all the time. You know, I did 53 workshops and reached nearly 500 young people. Now that's amazing to reach those young people who maybe never had this message before. But also within those groups, we're going to have some survivors who maybe have never knew that that was happening to them or never knew where to get support. So we offered that support side as well. And last year we supported 263 young people under the age of 25. So you can see that it's an issue. You know, our school workshops reached over 700 people. So we're there to provide that support. And what we want to do is get that prevention message out there and try and stop some of it from happening. We can help young people, especially young men, understand what rape and sexual assault is, understand what consent is, understand what's appropriate and inappropriate in a relationship, then maybe we can prevent some of this from happening. And I think just at the end, it's just some contact details for me. If anyone does want to get in touch about the Rosie Project, about the work that we do, that's the details up there. And thank you again for having me on today. I really appreciate it.
Particularly I was at another women's leadership conference a few weeks ago where they were talking about quotas on boards. And my whole thing about quotas is, yes, who ever said that the men on those boards who get onto boards of big companies and all that are the best? They're not. They're there because of their gender. They're not there because they're the best at the job. Some of them are. And all, so all we're campaigning for is the ability to be as shite as some of them are. Anyway, make a joke there, but there is a grain of truth in that. Who says that every selection of men for a political party, if they're going to stand for an MP, who says that all those men are the best? How many idiot MPs, MSPs of the male gender have we seen in front of us, paraded in front of us, and we're supposed to vote for them? So I am a huge campaigner and believer in quotas. I was, my feminist politics sort of, I've got me into trouble over the years, particularly if you are involved in something like comedy, particularly comedy in Scotland, which is a male-dominated, white male-dominated platform for comedy. And also central Belism as well, in that there are no many people from Aberdeen or Inverness or whatever, like, or the borders on there too. So for those of you who may look at me and go, that old woman seems to have done okay, I have. I'm not, but it's been a hard fight. It's been a really, really tough fight to get to where I am. And for a long time, I tried not to to be too outrageous. But then I realised I was colluding. I was colluding when you go, oh, well, the writers are great, the boys that write this are fabulous, the blah, blah. And they are. None of them sit in the morning writing sketches going, what are we going to do to women today? Or how are we going to ignore women? But what you realise is that when I started out, even in something like Naked Video, for the older members of the audience might remember, Naked Video was a sketch show before June the Fat and all that, a network sketch show. You couldn't, I couldn't play a doctor in a sketch because they would think that the sketch was about me being a woman doctor. Now you wouldn't think about that. Now a woman surgeon comes in and nobody thinks about that, but that's how difficult. Women had to be the nurse, the mother, the wife, the daughter if you were young enough. But and rarely did you ever get what we call in comedy the tag of the gag, right? That you never get the punchline. You get the feed, the men get the punchline. And so I felt I was really, you know, in Naked Radio, another sketch show we did, really forging ahead at one point and going, oh great, because the writers started hearing my voice and they started writing for me. So I would get monologues and I would get punchlines. And then I wasn't available, I was away doing a tour, and they got another actress in, lovely actress. She was straight back to being the wife, the nurse, the mother. So the men would write for me because they could hear me, but they actually, when they were thinking about women, then they were immediately in more minor roles all the time. But I never gave up on my politics. I've been on the board of, I was on the board of Zero Tolerance, and fighting against that fight you were talking about earlier on, about domestic violence, when that was something you could not talk about. I remember organising a big dinner about 10 years ago or something, just 10 years ago, for Zero Tolerance to raise funds in the memory of Elsie Ingalls to get funds out to women's groups across the place. And you wouldn't believe the amount of corporates that went, no, we don't want a table. They would have come to it if it's fluffy, if it's a children's hospital, if it's all good causes, but that was untouchable. And it was still at a point in Scotland where domestic violence was referred to by the police as, oh, it's just a domestic. It's a fight between a husband and wife, so that's okay, it doesn't matter who's right or wrong. We have come a long, long way from there. We still have a long road to travel. But the fact that it is even on the agenda, the fact that, I remember David Steele, I spoke at a conference, who was then Speaker of the First Parliament in Scotland. And he said to me, in all his years at Westminster, he had never, I'd written an article in the Herald about domestic violence, and he said, in all the years of Westminster, I never heard the words domestic violence uttered in the Chamber of Westminster. And I said, well, shame on all of you. Shame on all of you that you know. And he said, it did make us feel shame. It did make us feel, why is this an issue? And I said, well, it's mainly men there, mainly a certain type of man who likes to think that they're above the fray. And the article I had written was that this was not, domestic violence was not an issue that only applied to working class people, to as far as the Rab-C Nesbitts of this world were involved. There was doctors, judges, lawyers, part of the collusion and the way through the court system of domestic violence not being processed properly was because of a collusion amongst men. A wonderful, at one of the rallies I was at, it was actually a man who said, if men are the problem, and it's exactly what you were talking about, they are also part of the solution. We can't ignore them, we have to get the good men. And there are thousands and thousands and thousands of really good men out there. The problem is, my husband, I would like to think, is a good man, and he's always looked at great feminist politics from long before he knew me, left out feminist politics. And he said, the problem is, if you're a man and you stand up to other men, invariably, violence ensues. So if you're in the pub and you challenge other male behaviour, then it can end up in some form of standoff. So a lot of men, it's not that they don't agree, that in those situations it is really difficult to actually embrace and get out there. And that goes very much for young men as well. There was something you said earlier on as well about coming forward and standing, either standing up or admitting that you have witnessed or being the victim of some form of abuse through, because shame is attached to it. And Scotland certainly, and beyond, but Scotland is and many cultures within Scotland have shame almost tattooed across our forehead. And there's a wonderful woman, if you ever can get it, it was through Oprah, my hero. As soon as I saw Oprah, and she had her as a guest on the programme, and her name is Brené Brown, and she did a TED talk, and it was inspirational. You could go on YouTube and have a look at it. And she's written a book called I Thought It Was Only Me. And she actually has a social work background, she's a PhD, and she is she's very funny about it, because as she said, she does she'll be sitting on a plane going somewhere and people say, what do you do? Oh, I'm a PhD. What do you study? And she says, shame. And she said immediately everybody's like, oh, well, forget that. It's a way to end conversations. But she has studied the impact of shame on all walks of life, from political candidates right the way down to just that shame as a woman, that a young woman, when something's happened to you, that you're terrified to tell anybody. You're terrified to say, this actually happened to me. And she said, if you put shame, if something stuck with me, if you put shame in a petri dish, and you put it in, put the lid on, and leave it in a laboratory, it festers, it grows, it rots. And she said, if you take the lid off it, take the lid off and shine empathy onto it, it disappears. And that for me throughout, if there's a lesson to give you, that the power of other women and some good men, the power of those people when something has happened to me in my life that I'm ashamed of, or I've taken a wrong path, or it's happened to me, other women, and talking to them and them saying, oh my God, I know that happened to me. Or just going somewhere where you are heard, you're listened to. That is so vital, particularly in the way that women communicate with each other. And I love the fact that in Scotland, I watch my daughters, they live in the East End of Glasgow, I watch them, they meet their pals, they hug each other. We'd never have done that when we grew up. I see families hugging each other in a way, I mean ordinary working class families, but that would never have gone on before. So even in those very little ways throughout Scotland, things have changed and moved on a wee bit. But for young women, I suppose I've got hundreds of things to say here, but I'll be here all day and you'll be sleeping by the time I finish. But so my politics actually come from a place of saying to people, it's all right. It's all right, we can make this place better. We can go forward, bad things happen, but empathy and solidarity and young women particularly speaking to each other, take us forward. And they bring issues onto the agenda that 30 years ago I couldn't even have imagined. Now, you might not agree with Nicola Sturgeon's politics or anything she's saying. The fact that we have a feminist as our first minister, as a young girl, I could not even imagine. When I was embracing feminism in the 70s and 80s, I couldn't have even thought that there would be three women leaders of political parties in Scotland. Now, although there was a wonderful writer, Andrew Hagan, who's a friend of mine, and he said a wonderful thing, lives in London, but looked at the Scottish political scene and what's happened. And he left Scotland about 30 years ago. And he said, you know what you need to do in Scotland? Stop all the arguing, all the who did this and who said that in Parliament. Lift the camera up and back and see how far you've come. He said, because the Scotland you're living in is one I couldn't imagine. Hundreds of problems, loads of things to sort. Poverty, the biggest thing. But actually, when we look at where we are, we should maybe sometimes take a breath before we start fighting and arguing with each other about where we've got to. The fact that you can stand up here and talk about rape without there being some sort of a demonstration outside even about it, or a room full of women hanging their heads going, I kind of talked about that. So I actually thought, what my job is today is to inspire, really. I suppose I wish that I did somebody, not like me, but like all of the women here and this group when I was young, to just speak to not the women. There is a terrible tendency in older women, and I remember that when you were fighting for stuff. It's all right for your generation. Look at me, we had to put up there. It's not that we're saying that they were, you know, that what they went through wasn't terrible, but we have to go forward. And there was, I always use the bowling club analogy, you know, about women being difficult. In bowling clubs throughout, particularly the west of Scotland, that's the old grass bowling, they have committees generally full of men. You look at the names and all the winners are men and all that. And women get to play bowls, you know, every second Thursday or something like that. And the rest of the time they were supposed to come in and make the tea. And when women in the bowling clubs were saying, we would actually like to be full members. We'd like to be able to come and play every day in the bowls if we can, like the men are. Oh no. And see, the women were asked, they were basically quieted down by the other women. By the other women going, just don't cause trouble. Or men take their wives, tell that Margaret to shut her mouth. She's causing trouble. We don't want that. And women, it's back to shame again. You don't want to shame your husband or your partner. You don't want to shame yourself because we want to be nice. We want to be nice. But there's a great quote I actually brought today, a woman saying, I realised all those years when I was trying to be nice, I was just being chicken. I was being fear, and I'm desperate for people to like me. And that's the biggest message I want. Get that, because I've spent a whole lifetime, you know, trying to make people like you, and you'll never do it. You will never make everybody like you. You'll never make everybody think you're the most wonderful person in the world. But those people that, if what you're saying matters, it lands. If how you conduct yourself matters, it lands. People see it. So I suppose that message, don't be fear, don't be chicken, and don't worry all the time about having to be nice. And that thing of the bowling club analogy, really, we have to be realistic about how other women, a section of other women, don't want other women to succeed. They find it really, really difficult. I cannot believe the level of misogyny at times from other women about, no, it's not, we may disagree with politics, we may disagree with all these things, but you actually want to do a woman down all the time. There's something also, and this is a sort of funny thing I always mention, that there's a survey that came out a few years ago, just about 5 years ago, that it only takes 90 seconds for a woman's self-esteem to start to plummet when she starts reading a glossy magazine. So you're in the hairdressers, you're getting your colour done, you might be in there for 2 hours if you're my age to get all the green on, and you've maybe read 5 magazines. And you open the first magazine, 90 seconds, oh, I don't look like that. Well, the truth is, nobody looks like that. But I don't look like that. Oh, my house doesn't look like that. Oh, my kids don't look like that. My man certainly didn't look like that. So you're immediately feeling that you're in some way a failure, you know? And that way of judging other women, I mean, I have said to Nicola Sturgeon, I want to pass a law, I'm going to write to it, I want a law that the only magazines allowed in hairdressers should be the Bella and the Chat, because no matter how bad your life is, it's never as bad as Bella in the chat, and you can feel quite superior at the time as well. But the judging of women on the way each other look, that's the thing that drives me crazy, and I do it. And I think we all have to admit it, that it's something I hate myself, but I did. My mother was a master at it, sitting there when Lorraine Kelly came on in the morning, I would hear my mother, oh, for God's sake, what have they got you wearing today? This from Miss World, sitting in the in her old dressing gown with her front set of teeth out, a Friday piece, you know, busy judging other women all the time. And I think that is something, I don't think we'll ever stop it, but it's something we should be aware of, that that's what we do. And so, I want to read out some quotes to inspire you, that have inspired me. There's one of these things, right, to go with. Nobody objects to a woman being a good writer, a sculptor, a geneticist, if at the same time she manages to be a good wife, a good mother, good-looking, good-tempered, well-groomed, and unaggressive. So you can be successful as long as you get all the other bits right as well. That's rubbish. So please don't listen to that. And also, whatever women do, they must do twice as well as men to be thought of as half as good. Luckily, that's not very difficult. I love that quote. Anyway, it is true. But the thing I talk about in comedy being hard is I had to work 10 times as hard as the men who got much more notoriety. When I took over, now you might not go to pantomime or whatever, but me taking over as the headliner in the King's Panto was seen as a revolution, because women never got to headline, and women never got to play game either, because it was male comics that got to do that. And I had well-known male comics going, no, that'll never work, you know, I don't know why that's happening. To give them their due, every one of them phoned me up after it and said, yeah, I was wrong. Because it isn't actually whether you're a man or a woman that makes you a great panto performer, it's about the type of performer you are. If you're a performer that comes out and goes, I'm going to make an arse of myself, come on, then they go with you, because that's what being a dame is about. I've seen men be terrible dames, but they were still allowed. And there's another thing I've gone on about, how many women actually get to do it. You know, I did Aberdeen for 8 years, I've just left, they've replaced me with a man. Because they go, oh, we can't replace a lady. And I'm like, well, how come there's about 40 really mediocre or not very good men out there that get allowed to sort of ply their trade and they get allowed to mature? But women are. Women have to be the complete package. You've got to be a complete star before you even get the chance. It's unfair. So I do concur. I don't know whether you guys out there concur with all of that. Also, here's something I want, as I was saying about bowling clubs and the rest. Women who set a low value on themselves make life hard for all women. Those women who go, oh, well, no, I don't like to do it. I don't want to do that. No, that wouldn't be me. They harm us all by not stepping up to the plate. So you be desperately trying to be nice all the time, it doesn't do women, yourself or the rest of women any good. Each woman is being made to feel that it's her own cross to bear if she can't be the perfect clone of the male Superman, and of course the perfect clone of the feminine mystique. So that thing of perfectionism, but we have skills. As women, we have skills. And I'll tell you one of the things we do really well, we hustle. We're great at hustling, you know why? Because we have to. Because women read faces, we hear voices better, we read gestures, moods, faces, all that. The person, you know why? Because we have to survive. And we have to use everything. We have to use our cunning. When we're in a meeting full of men, or you're going on a course full of men, we're reading signals that men are to see how we can fit. And I don't agree with it, but actually, that's where we are. And here's the worst thing for me. The outpost of the enemy, and if the enemy is a lack of progress and misogyny, it's in our own heads. And that is the worst thing. That actually the voice in your own head telling you can't, you shouldn't, don't, be nice, all of those things, they are actually more harmful to us than anything else. Here's the other thing. People call us feminists whenever we express sentiments that differentiate you from a doormat or a prostitute. And that means if you actually come out and just say, I want to be heard, then you're seen as difficult. Oh, she's a mad feminist. All those adjectives that go in front of it. If you want, there's a great quote from Bette Davis as well, a great film actress who said, if you want a thing well done, just get a couple of old birds to do it for you, which is true. There is also, in many women now, a real level of workaholism. And I have had to really look at that. You switch your negative thinking to workaholism. That's how you continue to abuse yourself. Because what you do is, I'm not good enough. How do I do it? I'll just do everything. I'll try and be everything to all people. I'll have all these rules. And all you do is abuse yourself and knacker yourself as well. There's a great quote as well about how we perceive ourselves. And do you know that men look at themselves in a mirror? Women look for themselves in a mirror. And that leaves me feeling really sad. Eleanor Roosevelt had a wonderful thing. She said, no one can make you feel inferior without your consent. And I have, in my life, I have gone through feeling insecure and inferior, and I colluded. I let them make me feel that way. Not that I'm any great shakes, or that I think I'm better than anybody else, but those feelings of insecurity and I can't do this, why do I do that? Everybody feels that. And that's where the shame and empathy comes in again. Everybody feels that. But if you let it pervade into you, your very being, you're colluding with it. And here's something that I've got to remind myself of as well. We haven't actually had our freedom for that long as women. You know, when in 1968 was the first time a woman in Scotland could own her own checkbook. Let that sink in. You couldn't own property on your own. You couldn't have a mortgage. You couldn't have those. That's not that long ago. I was 10 then. And when I tell my daughters, they're like, what? They can't believe that. Again, take the camera up and back and see how far we've come. And one of the problems is that we have not owned that freedom long enough for us to know exactly how to use it. So we've got to forgive ourselves as well. Young, older women, younger women, we've made mistakes. We'll make more mistakes as we go along as well. We won't get it right because this is new. We're the first couple of generations of women to experience going out there into the world and making our way. And that's why we get it wrong. And people look to you and go, why is she doing that? Or you've got to be a pioneer. And one of the problems as well is that we don't know our history as women. We don't know in Scotland who came before, who fought those battles. When you actually look back, in the same way as we actually are not allowing ourselves to look at what Scotland's role was in the empire and what we did in the fight, in condoning slavery. Oh yes, there was a movement to fight against slavery throughout Europe, but much of the support for slavery was actually based in this city. With streets named after it, all of that, we have to own up. We have to own the shame, empathise with what went on, apologise and go forward. That, all of those things are really, really important things because people make mistakes. Generations make mistakes. They get things wrong. And we'll make mistakes. You'll make mistakes. All you beautiful young people out here. You'll make mistakes on the way forward. But if you walk away today with one thing of what has been said, one thing that you think, I remember that, that makes a difference. And it is those women in my life, older than me, wiser than me, who just gave little droplets of stuff to us to let us go forward. They sustained me through my life. So if that, I don't know whether that's depressing or uplifting, I want it to be uplifting for you. Normally I would say at this point, go forth and multiply, but maybe that might be taken wrong then. Please use precautions if you do. Thank you very much for inviting me along today. I hope just one sentence wasn't too boring and you thought, oh my God, what did she talk about? But, because that's what I get from my daughters. And I hope you have a great conference the rest of the day. And well done for putting it together, the organisers, and for all the speakers today as well. Thank you.